can you share your screen, please?
I am.
Okay,
yes.
Perfect.
Okay. So I am planning to cover as much as I can in next 3 hours. And so my plan of action is this. I have about 20 slides on this. And then I have few slides in this deck, which is a Kanban coaching special deck. I certainly want to cover this part. And then I have some photos from the conference that I attended after the training. So let us start with the overview deck, which is this. Oh. Oh yes, thank you. Sure, sure, sure. So all right. Starting with the overview. So in the first section, I'm going to compare Toyota Kanban with software Kanban. These are colloquial terms. They are not referenciable terms. That is, Toyota Kanban is known as Toyota Production System, and software Kanban is called capital K Kanban. Maybe we will spend about 15 to 20 minutes on this topic, because it is important to know what are the main differences in lean manufacturing and knowledge work. And with respect to those differences, how do you use a workflow management process like Kanban for creative work? And after that, we will jump into the process comparison. And then maybe after half an hour to 1 hour on this, because this is a heavy topic, you'll have a lot of questions, we will jump into the feedback loops in Kanban, followed by metrics and the team assessment model. These two we will do in the last session. So I'm assuming about 1 hour each, 45 minutes each for each session, and then 15 minute break. So these two could be first two topics could be first 45 minutes, 15 minute break. Feedback loops, I would want to spend some time. That could itself be half an hour to 45 minutes, and then these two in the last session. That is my plan. So what I would do is, for questions and answers, I would use those 15 minute time gap for Q&A, so that way I will be able to maintain my flow when talking about flow. Fair enough? Okay. I wish I could do the clicker thing also. Okay. So I have a quote from the Toyota Production System book written by Ono Taichi. That is how Japanese pronounce their first name and last name. Actually, Ono is his last name. Taichi is his first name, but that's how Japanese use names. So this is from the preface of that book, and this was, the context is that Taichi Ono had actually started a subcontracting company that supplied parts to Toyota Motor, and the interviewer was asking Taichi Ono, what is Toyota doing now? And his answer was very simple. So he said, all we are doing is looking at the timeline from the moment customer gives us the order to the point when we collect the cash. And we are trying to reduce that timeline by removing non-value-added waste. And then there is that order to cash diagram, simple diagram.
I'll be moving. It's easy for me to. No,
thank you. All right. So I will share these two decks with you. Unfortunately, in this style of presentation, I do not have the luxury of reading my notes that I use in PowerPoint to actually talk about some salient points. So for example, I mentioned that Kanban is actually a Japanese word and also Chinese word, and in both languages it means the same thing. Kan means to view and ban means billboard. Billboard, like a banner. Right? Kan means view, right?
Yeah.
See, to see. Thank you. We confirmed this with Kevin Chen. He actually told us that it's not just Japanese, it's also same thing in Chinese also. So when you use the word Kanban, if you recall what Anderson said in his keynote at PayPal last year, Kanban is the signal, or Kanban is the card that moves, right? So without going into the details of how it is used as a signal in manufacturing system, I want to jump to the point that I want to cover. I feel that from the TPS book itself, this is the highlight of the book, and you will want to revisit these six rules of TPS from time to time to compare and contrast with knowledge Kanban or Kanban for knowledge work. So the first rule, and I want to read this slowly, and if you have any questions on these, please raise your hand. First rule is the later process, that is manufacturing process, picks up the number of items indicated on the Kanban card at the earlier process. So if you are doing machine work first and then passing that to some polishing area, the polishing area looks at the Kanban card coming from machine work, looks at the number of items and only picks those many items. That is the first rule, that you are not overproducing. You are only producing work that downstream process can consume, number one. Number two, it was a little preemptive, you think about what I just said. Earlier processes produces items in the quantity and sequence indicated by the Kanban. So on the Kanban card, in this example of machining, there could be not just the number of items, but also the sequence of how the items would come. Because if it is a bill of material, then it could have several things coming on the shop floor. The next is, no items are made or transported without a Kanban. So in the previous part of the slide, you might have noticed that there are two different types of Kanban cards used in manufacturing. But without going into the finer details of that kind, all you want to know here is that nothing is made or moved without any supporting Kanban card. That ticket is the proof that it is required by downstream. So this is kind of corollary of that, that you always attach Kanban card to the goods. This is the one that I want you to think about and ask me several questions when we talk about processes further down the road. The point is very critical. If you read it, defective products are not sent to the subsequent process. Feels idealistic. Defective products are not sent to the subsequent board. So at the current process stage, if I manufacture something that is not up to my comfort level, I'm not going to push it downstream. That is what it says. So the point is about making 100% defect-free good. And we know that in software engineering, this is the nirvana state there. So just keep in mind that this is one distinguishing factor that you can never attain ever in probably our children's lifetime. And the last one is reducing the number of Kanban cards increases the sensitivity. This is about if you reduce the number of cards, it's like reducing the batch size. You'll have much more, I would say, throughput as well as lead time, cycle times, much more efficiency. I do not exactly mean by sensitivity here in maybe sometimes the context is not clear when you read it. What would you think? Something closer to that, I would say. Yes, yes. Sometimes, maybe in original Japanese or Japanese edition, it would have been much more clearer than the English. But the point is that you must have you must do every effort to reduce your batch size just to have much better flow. So now compare that with the knowledge work, Kanban. So Anderson created Kanban around 2008 or 2009. I don't exactly remember which year. Maybe earlier. I don't remember right now. So it's a management method based on just-in-time delivery. Management method of just-in-time delivery based on capacity to do work. So looking at how much we can produce, you use just-in-time delivery mechanisms to manage work. So main point is not to overload the system nor the people who are part of the system. So the main part in Kanban is that it is a workflow management tool, really, not a process framework or anything. It is considered tool more than a process framework. And the point is that you're visualizing the workflow from definition to delivery, and workflow is visible to the team members, and I would in fact extend this to stakeholders also. So that is really the last point about having a visual process management system, workflow management system that tells what to produce. That means the cards that flow on the board, how much to produce. That's the WIP limits on each queue on the board. And a lot of background comes from TPS and lean manufacturing. Yes. I recall him talking about using it for telecom industry, not just for software or software development, but also issue management. In his book, if you see, he talks a lot about change request management. In the Kanban book, talks a lot about change request management. So, yeah. So serviceability agenda is of course. And lean manufacturing. Yes. The knowledge work point of view, So with exceptions of, that's why I was referring to the rule number 5 from TPS. If you see 100% defect-free goods, passing on to the subsequent process is like a dream in knowledge work. It
otherwise it's pretty close.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Well, pretty much all.
Yes.
But the TQM part of it, that's the part of your recipe.
Yes.
Total quality management.
Right.
Defect.
Yes. Right. Yes. So I think last time I covered this topic, I had only this slide, and maybe some of you remember this slide, which I was mentioning, in which I mentioned that when you use visual boards like this, you have what Anderson calls as proto Kanban, which is having queues starting from ready to done with maybe some sub-columns in various queues just to clarify certain things happening in that specific queue. So if you remember at that time I mentioned that the clock starts for lead time, the clock starts on the when the card is at the first queue, created in the first queue, and it ends at the first infinity queue. You could have a lot of infinity queues after the first infinity queue. So the queues from the first ever queue in Kanban up to the first infinity queue must have some kind of list. That is the point here. When teams are doing proto Kanban,
so you think engineering very teams are, I mean, like the card is created at that time when you're saying that the clock starts on the first queue.
Yes. That is your request queue or ready queue. This is where you have the board start or first ever queue in your work value stream. So you may call it ready, you may call it request, you may call it input, whatever that name is.
So as soon as the request is generated, not when it is touched by being generated.
No, absolutely.
Okay. So that's the request.
Exactly. As soon as you create a card here. Okay. Now, later on, when we talk about planning in Kanban, we will talk about what is known as upstream Kanban, which is what Scaled Agile Framework calls Portfolio Kanban. And I was talking to Pragya in the morning about what that kind of planning is and how it is done. But I certainly want to talk about it later. So you may have the point about that is that you use this proto Kanban board to do the execution of work. The planning of that work happens in yet another Kanban board called either upstream Kanban board or just planning board.
Okay.
So that is your planning process and this is your execution workflow. You could have a separate planning workflow to plan higher grain items. At this level, you are actually in the execution mode. Proto, so this is a term again used by Anderson and the Lean Kanban community that he has created. I asked him this question, that is it like Scrum but, and he said no. When you use the term Scrum but, you are actually already getting into some coaching mode or you are talking in more or less derogatory terms that you are doing something wrong here. The Scrum by the book doesn't work like this. That is your intent when you use the term Scrum but. His point was that when you use the term proto Kanban, that is when teams first time, or newbie teams, when they try Kanban first time, they are doing proto Kanban. So they're just only visualizing work. They haven't done anything beyond visualizing work to identify bottleneck. That's all they're doing at that level. So this is, and I like it because it is close enough to say that I'm creating some software, but I need to do some discovery and refine my requirements, and at that point in time I'm getting into prototyping mode. So that's not necessarily a bad thing to do some POC for discovery of what is feasible and what is not, so that I can take on something much more realistically. So there is some positivity there, that by prototyping your Kanban value stream, you are actually going to use the experience out of that prototyping of the value stream for some real Kanban that happens later.
And I think we're trying to get us to create a physical board, right?
Yes. Or virtual Kanban board.
That's a good way to really try it out.
Yes, exactly. Absolutely. You have a very valid point. That physical tactile experience in a spatial manner gives you much more clarity of thought when you go forth with your Kanban implementation.
You got it right. This board may not change in terms of categories.
Or value stream.
Or value stream.
Mm-hmm.
The point at which the process of the maturity of the team
going
through this journey.
Yes.
Right? Moving into Kanban.
Absolutely.
They're visualizing how things work.
Yes.
And then they actually get into, you know, norming and storming and all that. Right.
Very good point. So I want to bring our attention to this part, that at this level we may have explicit policies and WIP limits based on the cues. So you may have clear understanding of what is meant by leaving each cue, the definition of done for each cue. So in the next slide, you will see that as teams progress, even though the value stream hasn't changed at all, like you said, they have added much more clarity in terms of maybe adding subcolumns and maybe having subcolumns level WIP limit. We don't know how much refinement they can get into, right? But the important part is now the WIP limits are not just queue-based, but they are also swim lane-based. And those swim lanes are either classes of service, or they are work type based, or they are combination of the two. I like the combination part more, like the ops swim lane that you see here, that the first swim lane is always expedite with a WIP limit per day. The last swim lane is always intangible with perhaps WIP limit of per quarter or per month, whatever grain, whatever time duration they want to have that WIP limit by. But that's because it's easy for any team, newbie or mature, to say what is urgent. So that's why you have expedite lane in Kanban when you do simulation or learn Kanban. And then it's easy to say what is intangible. What do I not know is pretty clear to team at any point in time. I relate that to the deep backlog that we talk about in product owner training. So when you talk about product backlog, you have the low-hanging fruits at the top of the product backlog, things that we can do, we know enough about, that we can iterate on. And the epic stories and the large grain items stay at the bottom of the product backlog. Same idea here. Your intangibles are very much similar to those epics. And in between, you can probably have work types, contextual. And as you gain more experience with the Kanban system, you can have even sub rows or divide those swim lanes into multiple. Those are classes of service. The point about classes of service is that from serviceability point of view, you are getting lot of requests. If you use class of service, each class of service has its own SLA. Therefore, you can have some mechanism that, you know what, not everything can be urgent, not everything can be intangible. If I break the work that is coming from demand intake perspective into these four classes, I can easily do something about that. That expedites are always highest important. Fixed come next, standard SLAs come next, and then intangible. So each SLA is growing, as you can see. Fixed will be Mm-hmm.
What if you keep getting cards for expedited things? And how about what happens to standard and indent?
So that's where your whip limits come into it. That I, even though everything here is urgent, you can maybe handle one or two urgent cards every day. Based on the historical empirical data, you have to refine that whip limit. So you will probably have, even though everything is high priority, you can definitely do stack ranking and maybe demote some high priority items to standard or intangible, depending on what is urgent, what is more urgent, I would say. Exactly, and what can you do? What is your capacity to do those? Yes.
Two partially available, two half-time BSA.
Mm-hmm.
We actually needed two.
Mm-hmm.
So we were one BSA, or two BSA short, we need three. And ETLs, we were short as well.
Yes.
And so we, now we have to, you know, make some adjustments. It's just too much work.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
You know, there's so many cars at a time for each area.
Yes. Yes. So the other important thing I want to cover is the work type. So you asked me about the class of service. Now what is work type and why and how are you going to use those percent allocations? So if we have exact mandate that NPD, new product development, has to be 60% at most, tech has to be 30% at most, and innovation should be 10%, I would say minimum, not at most. If that is the kind of mandate we have, based on the number of cards, you can easily see that if I start tagging each card as one of the three work types, I can quickly say with the color of the cards or any visual cue will tell us whether we are NPD heavy or tech debt heavy, or we are actually naughty and ignoring the defects that are created. So you will start adding these concepts to your Kanban board as you start going away from proto Kanban. And then the other thing that I was talking about is that if you're using physical board for co-located team and a virtual board for sharing what you're doing here with remote team, you got to have both synced. At a company where I worked at in the past, we were actually syncing physical boards across the sites. That was a mandate from the exec director, that you got to use boards, stick to stickies, and when you were sticking with the stickies, if Ravi was Scrum Master in San Jose or Bangalore, he was always syncing up with another Scrum Master on the same product line to know exactly what the status was. So you got to, if you're using a combination of physical boards and virtual boards, they should be in sync. Otherwise, one out of sync situation, and you will not know which one is the source of truth. The other thing is that it is important to think about cadence-based work, so that there you get into some kind of predictability of your Kanban system. By adding cadence to the Kanban board, such as month or week or whatever your domain allows for, that will not only reduce the granularity of the cards that are moving on the board, but also you will have some satisfaction that we are actually moving cards. Otherwise, you will have aging problems that epics don't move across the queues at all and such. So this is one reason why I like to think about a Kanban system as a time box based card movement mechanism, visualization mechanism, that if I can have parent stories, the child stories of which are visualized here on the board, then even though there is planning board and portfolio Kanban and all of that great stuff that upper management is interested in rolling up, from execution point of view, I can really do something quickly and be satisfied with that work that I'm doing. If I continue to not break down work on the Kanban board, then I will not have that job satisfaction that I will have with this approach. Fair enough. So if you don't have questions on that one, I will jump into this session. Shall we wait for him for a couple of minutes? What's the time?
Yeah.
I have plenty. This 45 minutes practically.
So we stop at 15 minutes, right?
So maybe half an hour. Okay. So this is the heaviest section, and then the metric section is also heavy. But we have one, two. You also know what we have done so far. Greg, you also have a fairly good idea about the metric. That's what I was thinking. First, I will go through the slides, and then at this kind of break, I will have chance to have Q&A. Yes. Because I have, even though the number of slides are less, they are a little heavy. During my slide reviews, other coaches that I have been showcasing this material to, they always told me that some of this stuff is heavy, so you may have to paste it out or create multiple slides, so that is. And then after this today's session, you may have some more feedback for me to clean up some of this. Yeah. I have both decks with him, and I don't think I've changed anything, but I'll send both of these to everyone. Because like I said early on, I have a lot of notes that are really useful. I like to use notes in PowerPoint a lot, because when you are in notes mode, you can actually have free form text there, a lot of bullet points, talking points, and you can have one monitor where the notes is running, you can have another one for sharing. Okay, so this section is about making decision as to what process works best for your kind of context, and this is based on a lot of reading that many of us, primarily Steve and maybe Greg, Netra, you also participated early on. So it all started when we started talking about Kanban. And after reading Corey Ladders, the creator of Kanban's original essay on the topic for about 3 or 4 times, I could make some sense of it. And with Steve, I came up with this definition, which actually Steve noted. I copied that note here. So level one Kanban is few teams here, like the product team, for example, that I work with, the Scrum team. But given the fact that you cannot commit to the content, meaning you do not know in the next 2 weeks what you really will work on. You know probably this week, but you're not too sure about what next week commitment. So then in 2 week sprint, you are having that scenario or symptom that our team cannot commit to any content here. So teams get value out of the feedback loops in Scrum in terms of daily feedback, daily Scrum, daily stand-up, the retrospective towards the end of the sprint, the grooming, the midpoint usually. And then the initial planning. The planning is not commit point, unlike Scrum teams in this case, because you can only plan for maybe first few days of the sprint. You may not be able to plan for the rest of the sprint because of the historical experience with your changing product backlog or sprint backlog. The point is that you want to empty whatever queue you commit to you want to empty that queue in that time box of 2 weeks or what have you. And the other thing I noticed is that we don't split stories in this kind of working style. Because you're not committing to a sprint backlog at the beginning during planning, by splitting stories you don't really achieve anything. Because the stories that got split at the last day might not have been part of the initial commitment, right? So you want to move stories in this kind of case. That is Kanban level 1. Any questions on Kanban level 1? Any observations? Because I want to hit this point very hard. So you look like Scrum team on the face of it. You have 3 roles, you have the 3 ceremonies. So everything looks like a Scrum team. It's just that your sprint backlog has some change. I have experienced this a lot with R&D team where they don't necessarily have fully committable sprint backlogs, or let alone release backlog. I'm talking.
So is this also the time box?
You will have time box of 2 weeks, but you do not know what you will really be doing in the next week. You may have some clarity for the first few days in the first week, but based on your empirical experience with the team, the product owner and the team might agree to the fact that our backlog is a moving target. We will commit to something based on what we know up to that week. We will commit to something for the next 2 weeks with the caveat that this is going to change during the mid-sprint.
Isn't this a problem that the tester is available, but then development is not ready yet for the tester?
Huh. No.
He's ready to test it. And but there is no finished development items tested by him.
No, I would not consider that context here, because what we are talking about is non-committal sprint backlog. That's really the point here. We are not talking about whether there are some people with lot of slack and there are some people with absolutely overloaded. You see what I mean? We are not talking about that scenario.
I'm trying to think of what
means. Yes.
So
in product we have product team which for last several months, ever since PayPal Touch started, haven't been able to commit to a sprint backlog.
That's my question. So
because PayPal Touch created a lot of variability in terms of supporting PayPal Touch over their committed line items. So even though they have Thursday meetings with product managers from product, business, wallet, product lines, and they commit to 2 week work, they still run into this situation where something takes higher priority and top the line situation occurs. And
but
then
that is not no commitment.
No.
If
I'm not saying
something comes up and that becomes a higher priority, then that's a no commitment, then it's not a no commitment.
But do you see the situation that the sprint backlog is then is no more the original commitment?
But then that's a very theoretical scam again, right?
No.
That you commit to sprint backlog, you don't do even 5% changes.
That is actually how you're supposed to use Scrum. You are supposed to say, what is my real capacity for next 2 weeks, and I am going to have my skills, my availability, and all that factored in and commit to the next 2 weeks, and almost nothing changes. You may have some buffer from.
And I would say 95% of the companies are not in Scrum. Yeah. So this support,
I see
here. Enterprise level. Scrum teams, programs,
mm-hmm.
these
Mm-hmm.
You got a product portfolio, product
company. Yes.
Roadmap on that.
Yes.
Releases, multiple releases to your product.
Yes, yes.
Then your scrum backlogs, multiple scrum backlogs roll up to a product.
Release backlog. Absolutely.
And if you can lay out your stories across quarterly releases along the roadmap,
mm-hmm.
then you have something that's committed at some level.
Absolutely.
And therefore,
so,
you're not just thinking 2 weeks out. You're having to think about even three, four quarters
further down. So, no,
I'm
where?
I'm saying safe. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, no, no, absolutely.
That's the way companies operate.
No, no, exactly. So where you're coming from, Pradeep, is our kind of scrum team. If you really work with scrum teams on stable product line with committed releases for a quarter or two quarters ahead, you do not run into the scrum ban situation.
Talks about it, right? Scrum Alliance says that even if change comes in, that's very well acceptable. Coaches say that it is acceptable.
No. Okay. Not for a time bomb. So, can we take that?
So the question I have is regarding
uh-huh.
Yes. It's an important thing to talk about.
Yeah, sure.
Yes.
Just to clarify for how we apply this here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
How does this fit into our
environment? So, we are doing that from on level one right now. Because what we are doing, what we commit to is the first day of the sprint is not exactly what we deliver towards the end of the sprint. Because
yeah.
it changes in the middle. So that's what
yeah.
that's what we are doing.
Yeah. On
Kanban level one.
No, so.
It's not wrong. It's just a fact.
Yes. So the nature of work here requires that kind of iterative process. And therefore, my observation has been that we are not really having scrum teams here. Those teams are called Kanban teams. They are not really scrum teams.
Things could fall out that when you're talking about a product, most of data, most of PC services.
That is correct.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Product, you can make this autonomous decision. We are very linked to a BU.
Yeah.
That's the point about it. Yes, exactly. Yes, I agree. Yes, and then level two is where you use the time box as a forcing function on the Kanban team, saying that if you time box, there is chance that you will finish something in that time box. Maybe month, quarter, maybe 1 week. So that is the other kind of Kanban that Corey Lewis talks about. In his essay where he mentioned Kanban first, he considers level two Kanban to be the ha level in Shuhari. So Shuhari, you know, the leadership, what is it called? Technique or
it's a Japanese term for things. You follow the practices blindly.
Yeah, kata.
Yeah, just follow
yeah.
what the master tells you.
Yeah.
And how you evolve when you, as an independent, then you start evolving. Yeah. That's in the final stage, you can change practice.
That's right.
That's the evolution.
Yes. So re is where you are expert and you actually contribute to the practice. And high is more like a practitioner level that you have grown. It becomes second nature. You don't have to think about doing the kata anymore. You have ingrained it. And you are evangelist of that practice. Re is when you actually start contributing. Then you are more like an expert level. So with that respect, Corey Ladas, when he introduced Kanban in his essay, he talked about level two as being the higher level or the high level, I would say. So what I did is I took some of his quotes and I have split some slides based on his quotes. But before then, I have this slide which is critical, and I have reviewed this a lot many times with you as well as a few others. I'm not too sure if I showed this slide in the first presentation, but this one actually is a first level comparison between Scrum, Kanban, and Kanban. And my context here is stories, user stories, compare how that concept is used in the three processes. Compare feedback mechanism and talk about time boxing. So let me start with the easy ones, because we'll have less debate on the easy ones. So time boxing here. So in Scrumban or Kanban, there is no distinction between sprints and releases. So iterations and releases, there's no semantics attached to those terms. It's just a simple term there called time box. So Kanban doesn't use any time box. Scrumban uses time box. That time box can be released if it is a larger than the 1 month iteration time box that Scrum has. Or it could be a sprint if it is 1 month or less in Scrum, as in Scrum. So the important point is that burn down is not as much important. The pending work is not as much important than what time you take in terms of the cycle times and lead time for that work that you say is pending. See what I mean? In pure Scrum, I am more interested in what is burning down and what is remaining, the last mile. But in Kanban or Scrumban, it is not what is pending. It's really how much time you are taking, because the point is about replenishment. So let's see. The next one that, according to me, is easy and we don't need to have too many arguments about is user story template. This actually rattles a lot of purists that we thou shall use user story format as a so that I want so that, and then acceptance criteria and so forth. Scrumban or Kanban, they don't care what you call it. It's just a Kanban card. It can be a user story. It can be a task or activity card for all you know. And the point is, can you move it as fast as you can with shortest possible lead time? And this is why it doesn't really make sense to have so much focus on estimating work in Kanban or Scrumban, because it is important that the cards on the Kanban board are of similar size than having well-defined baseline and using that baseline of story pointing against cards on the Kanban board. So let me repeat, it is much more important to have cards that you can really work on in a given time box, and that can be a week, month, day, whatever you're comfortable with, rather than worrying about estimating work. So prefer to have typical sizes over following any template per se. But at the same time, my experience has been that decomposition doesn't go away. There are 10 techniques to slice user stories in terms of vertical slicing. Those techniques are still useful here because when you use the word Scrumban, time box is given. And when you time box things, you want to slice work. So I read recently one Kanban coach recommends extreme programming style. What is it, elephant? You clarified to me that term, the elephant something. So there are a couple of extreme programming techniques that have evolved recently to slice work, to decompose work. Sesame, what was that one? Product Sesame, that is one. And elephant something to start with C, some Italian stuff.
Carpaccio.
Yeah. Some new style of slicing requirements. You know, XP keeps on evolving, so there's always something new in terms of best practice. So no matter what practice you use, decomposition doesn't go away. It would be nice to have Scrum style story map for that matter, and then take the leaf nodes of that story map and start visualizing them on Kanban. You will start seeing value of the visualization right away. So the last point that I want to make here is feedback mechanism. Feedbacks in Kanban are very different. So in Scrum, how many levels of planning? 5 levels of planning? Yes, and what are those 5 levels of planning? So you start with daily standard, that is daily feedback loop. Then you have... Sprint planning, that is sprint level feedback loop. Release planning, release level feedback loop. Road mapping, that is roadmap level feedback loop. And vision level feedback loop. So you start with visioning the product. Then you roadmap the product based on the vision. Then you plan releases for that roadmap. And then you create iterations or sprints for that release. And then you have daily standards for that sprint. 5 levels of planning. What do you have in Scrum? I mean, Kanban or Kanban. I'll come to that. I have a separate section. But at a very high level, there are 3 levels of feedback loop in Kanban or Kanban. Level 2 Kanban, I would say. The first level is daily stand-ups. They don't go away. It's just the mechanics of doing daily stand-ups is very different in Kanban because the size, team size is not an issue in Kanban, unlike Scrum. The average lead time and WIP limit adjustment require a different approach to grooming and planning and replanning in Kanban. Unlike Scrum, where you have a cadence to plan, in Kanban, we use average lead time to plan work. So that creates a different meeting. So the second level feedback is really, really filling the available slots. That's the point in planning. As it says here, focus of planning in Scrumban and Kanban is to fill available slots in the first queue. And not necessarily all of them, just the available, the ones that you have capacity to work on. That is really what that means. And the last is the operations review, which is having overview of how are we doing in terms of our execution. Exactly. Cadence is probably monthly or quarterly. It depends on what is the best fit in a given situation. Mm-hmm. Replenishment meeting is, there's a different term. I used to initially call it input queue replenishment meeting based on my training, but in recent decks, Anderson has changed the name of that meeting. And that is dependent on what is the most, it depends on the stats around your lead time. What is the modal lead time? What is the average lead time? What is the median? Based on that, you decide as a team, what is our best meeting time to fill the available slot in the request queue.
So would it be fair to say, you can have sprints in Kanban, sorry, Scrum.
Yes.
In Scrum, you fill your first cycle of the value stream, mm-hmm. all the work that's going to be done in 2 weeks, and at the end of the 2 weeks, every column value stream is empty.
I would go little one step over that. In release planning, you come out with a release plan, but your confidence level is much higher for first couple of iterations. You're not too clear about what slots you can fill in for the iterations following maybe the second. In really complex domain, maybe you can do only first release planned, and then you can do a continuous planning type of pre-planning meeting. Some teams do it that way. Just few days before the next iteration starts at the product line level, I've seen pre-planning meetings where they say, what should we do as our next 3-week time box?
One more.
No, even Scrum, you may not necessarily have a full release plan. You may have a release plan with confidence level of the first sprint. Yes, so my context was that you do pretty much the same thing in release planning in Scrum, that you are actually filling in the first few Scrum time boxes, sprints, and you're not really bothered about sprint 3, 4, and so on. I want to come back to your question on sprint planning, though, because I thought I heard you saying columns, queues. Can you repeat?
Yes, so my point was, in Scrum, you preload your backlog for the sprint.
Mm-hmm.
The idea that by the end of the
2 weeks
sprint, all the columns are empty of accepted.
That is true, yes.
And then with Kanban, you have the replenishment meeting when you need to pull in more work.
Yes.
The next, there's available work.
Beautiful, beautiful. Beautiful, because the next in Kanban is not cadence-based. The coach who talks, and I'm a little bit preempting some stuff here, but the deep Kanban or Kanban team assessment coach, the coach who created that assessment, uses the term next. He doesn't call it input queue. He uses the term next. So he says next is not time box-based. Next is based on your lead time style. So because of that, I mean, that's the real difference. You're filling in some slots on that next queue or input queue.
Ravi, you also said in Kanban our expectation is by the end, the maritime time box ends, all the columns are empty, right?
Not necessarily.
That is
another thing. Beautiful point. I will be more.
You can't do that.
No.
Let's say the time box is a 15 days.
Pradeep. No. Pradeep, you have a super point, and I need to maybe add something on that. That unlike Scrum, where you have this expectation, like you said, that during sprint demo, maybe you want to have 80% acceptance percentage, such that 80% of work is accepted, and maybe there is 20% where you need some rework. But you, according to development teams, not product owners, they think that they created acceptable work.
Right.
And there is that feedback between the PO and the team. In Scrumban, you may run into a situation that even though the team knows its capacity, but maybe because of the complexity of the domain or whatever it is in terms of unplanned events, that they could only, for the time box, finish 50% of the work. And the remaining 50% were in whatever queues they were. See what I mean? That can happen in Scrumban. If it happens in Scrum, hopeless situation. Yes. Yes.
The hope is by the end of the sprint, they've gone through all the different queues, and they're all either in, some kind of done or ready.
Completed or accepted. They should, your hope is they should be in one of these two.
So you would have gone through all of the sheets, that is.
But Naitra, what you might see is the teams that are known for overcommitting might not even pull some stories that will still stay undefined. I can show you some examples historically in Rally. No, they will commit, but they might not have pulled anything from defined. You see what I mean? Even on the last day. I've seen that happening. Exactly. Yes. Exactly.
End of the Scrum cycle.
Mm-hmm.
What if they pull in a new system? I don't understand that system. Why would you pull in the middle of the system?
No. So that's another question I want to tackle. Pradeep, I think we can take this next question, which is a nice question. You are... I thought I heard something different.
Towards the end of the sprint cycle,
hear her. I thought it was a little different.
Yeah, that, no, that's what I'm saying. That what if that right before the end of the cycle you pull it in, right?
Why would you, why would you
want to pull it?
No, so, no. So let me clarify.
Is, you're not committing, right? You're on day one, you're not committing to everything, right? So you are committing to as and when it's coming in, or you're pulling in pretty much as and when it's coming in, right? So let's say...
This is Scrum, level one.
Yes. It is a Scrum team with some backlog that is sometimes moving target.
So, yeah, exactly. Scrum level one.
Yes.
So you're saying that they are really committed only when they pull it in.
Mm-hmm.
But I would argue that Scrum Bar is more Scrum,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
You shouldn't be even pulling it in the first place. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Like, you shouldn't have the space of overcoming of absolutely, and hopefully you have buffer.
Mm-hmm.
You should not be pulling it in any way towards the end of the week, but you shouldn't be pushing that.
What if there is something which is like expedite, or that says like it is a high priority?
Agreed. So that's where Scrum one starts differing from the Scrum process. The team will still be like doing all the three roles, all the three ceremonies, but the fact that they are having some implicit, let me clarify, having some implicit classes of service, which means they are not necessarily using a Kanban board because they think they are a Scrum team. They are looking at their iteration burn down, yet they are running into this situation of pulling last minute expedites for dealing with unplanned over the committed backlog. Right?
The expedite of like reasons over whatever standard, right?
Yeah, but see, keep in mind that these are Scrum like team, right? Yeah. They are not necessarily using a Kanban board, therefore they don't even have the explicit view of expedite lane. For them it is in their head that this thing is unplanned yet expedite. It is not, there's no explicit policy like there's only two expedites per sprint or anything like that.
The Kanban that you explained so far, that completely means that's more Kanban than Kanban. It's more towards Kanban. The basis for your definition of Kanban is more Kanban than
Kanban. That is true. Where? So just to...
What I have gone through is it's more Scrum than Kanban. To accommodate unplanned activities, they use this expert to help the teams complete their unplanned as well as
planned.
But
okay.
They do commit to use
yes.
And for a sprint. And they can go through that and make sure, I mean, that's probably closer to level two that you are
at. Level two is a Kanban with time box. Level 2 is not a Scrum team. Level 2 is actually a Kanban team.
Level 1 and level 2 are not, it's a totally different level. But
yes.
Continue, just finish your sentence.
So, in Kanban, based on my experience, you completely commit to the user.
Just like any Scrum team would.
And allocate, let's say, 15-20% of your activity as unplanned activity, which will support.
That's what it
No. Yeah, carry on. Yeah, go ahead.
Both expedite or urgent request or unplanned.
Yes.
It can be urgent or it may not be urgent, but it is very important for the organization to do that.
So when you have that Slack built into your commitment, that is actually just like any high-performing Scrum team would. You see what I mean?
Wait.
Just a minute. Yeah, just let's hear from you.
So one thing I've heard by practitioners is that you take Scrum, and just in the same way that you apply Kanban to any process, whether it's happy, waterfall, you just start to visualize and use it as a way of measuring and tweaking your process. So you start with regular Scrum, you apply Kanban, and then you look for these areas of improvement. And I think that it's pretty much
what was for the team.
Yes, yes.
Slightly different for different teams.
But
yes.
So there is no exact definition.
Mm-hmm.
Ravi, you just contradicted yourself. You said any high-performing team will do that. 5 minutes ago you said it should be 100% coming up.
No. So it
on what Vijay is talking about is neither of the two levels of it.
No, but that's what I that's what my point was.
No,
so
what he's saying is
you will
20% buffer. You behave like a Kanban system.
Yeah.
That's what I said, like, you know, that any thing that comes, two of my teams are doing the same way. But you, level is one and level two is more like Kanban. No. If you read his article, okay, yes.
So I'm writing an article right now about what models to use when, that would help here to know when to use, what are the guidelines for using Scrum on level 1 and 2 and
Yes. So I actually, absolutely.
Because an interesting point is around, you see those quadrants like, you know, the problem, you know, what's the slightest problem, whether it's known or unknown.
Yes.
And the solution is known. Often those quadrants, agile and lean methodologies, those quadrants.
Yes.
It's not easy sometimes. There's a lot
of
overlaps and gray areas.
Yes.
But what I wanted to point out is that when you talk about Kanban, one of the prerequisites is that stories need to be, cards need to be of like size. And that's a critical thing when you look at an unknown problem, a known problem.
Yes.
So
but you have to
When do you use these methodologies that you talk about?
I do have a slide there. But you brought up a good point about this section, which is typical sizes. This, when I'm talking about typical size, this is about execution Kanban or team Kanban. There is that portfolio Kanban, which is the planning Kanban or planning board. That is where you may end up having SML, all kinds of work, small, medium, large, or any, because it is portfolio. Who can at best have some kind of guesstimate estimate in terms of t-shirt sizes for portfolio items, especially in areas that you have never worked before. So it may not apply to portfolio Kanban. You will have sizes only for execution Kanban. See what I mean? Two different things.
So for execution teams, which methodology, what guidelines are picking the right Scrum to lean methodology?
Yeah, so in terms of...
I'm just throwing that out.
Sure.
Question for you to answer.
So the teams that need a time box concept, they should use Kanban. The team that cannot have any time box concept for whatever release, non-releasable requirement, they are pure Kanban team.
Perfect. That's
so, I mean, operations team. I cannot imagine what releases they can have and who will benefit from those internal releases. Whereas release engineering, I do not mind trying Kanban because I think release calendars should have dot releases, major releases, minor releases,
right,
and those are internal releases or perhaps external releases that lend itself to a nice time box table situation. Yes, complexity.
And that's like the R&D cycle.
That's true. Yes.
Innovation to me.
Correct.
So this one was out there.
Yes.
A couple improvements.
Yes, absolutely.
And then we could use as practitioners, we know which one to apply when. I know we have that tool to pick out what's the best tools for a team. I'm just throwing that out there.
Yes.
You know, we're with new people.
Yes.
We're trying to figure out what's the best methodology. We've got teams that are really complaining about the methodology.
Yes.
What options do we have? What advice do we have?
Right. Yeah. Absolutely. So I have three slides which I have a lot of negative feedbacks on, and I tried my level best to to clarify them and also highlight the right points. These are quotes from Corey Ladas's essay on Kanban. That is an essay that I read at least 8 to 10 times while fine-tuning this material. You will get my slides, so I'm going to skip this because it is just read out. But the highlight of this slide, for example, is that when you are thinking about Kanban, do not think about the product burn down. Pending work is important. Yes, you got to know what is pending, but it is important to know what is the sustainable pace. Because if you think about focus in lean is, can you have sustainable pace? And for you to think about sustainable pace, you have to think about lead time and cycle time much more than the pending work. You may be having pending work that is most urgent or least urgent or somewhere in between. But okay. So this is one slide. I have another one on this actually goes back to the question that Naitra, you and Pradeep asked. So this is about, you know, what should be the size of iteration backlog in the context of Kanban? Do you really need iteration backlog, like a sprint backlog? So if you say that you are just running like a Scrum team with a moving target, then why backlog? Then why have backlog? So that is one question. The other is, what percent, like you said, 20% buffer for our planned work, and imagine an implicit expedite lane and such. So there are approaches to solve that problem, right? What Corey Ladas says here in this particular paragraph, which I really liked, is that consider sprint backlog is as the smallest inventory to optimize planning cost. Meaning, instead of, so what is your planning cost? Planning cost is coming up with a plan. That's your planning cost. So you want to optimize your planning cost by having smallest inventory. What does he mean by smallest inventory? Meaning have, let's say, a fixed size that we will work on 10 items as team XYZ during our Kanban iterations or releases, whatever that time box is. So just have that backlog of a fixed size, and it might run into zero before the time interval ends. You see that? Okay, so if as a team we say that we will work on 10 items every 3 weeks or every 2 weeks, what if in the last few days you don't have anything to work on, you have finished all those things? You will run into that situation, right? So he says it doesn't matter. And then he goes into the calculation, which are closer to something called as Little's Law, and I'll revisit that. But I should give you some time to read this. No. He's saying fixed size of the backlog item. Yeah.
For example, if everything is a backlog.
Yeah, something like that. And have 5 of those.
Exactly.
It's not about what's the size. It's about the number of items. That's where he's coming. Fixed size of the smallest inventory. Inventory meaning how many items. How many items in your sprint backlog. That's what he's talking about.
So it's
yes.
Yes.
So that's what he says, that what is your pace, what is your average cycle time, and in a sense what he's talking about is how much can you do in a given time box is all dependent on how much you produce on a regular basis, which is your cycle time. And then average it out and see So these kind of equations, when you do, you're using this little slug, which is, what should be my width? What should be my work in progress? Which is sprint backlog here. And the calculation is very simple. What is your delivery rate or throughput? Multiply that with your average time, lead or cycle time. Yes, exactly. You're just trying to figure out, can it be smaller? That's another thing. So that the point is, can you finish work on 7th and 8th day? Recently, Steam and I read an article written by a Kanban coach, which I have actually referenced in this, either in reference section or somewhere. And he says that, remember that article about looking at Scrum from Kanban lead time distribution perspective? His point is that when you have 2-week commitment, go for only commit to work that you can finish in 1/5 of the sprint length. Only commit to work that you can finish in 1/5 of the sprint length. He says that's how I coach Scrum Masters. And his point is that you will have to deal with unplanned work, you will have to deal with rework in terms of refactor and such. So there are several approaches out there.
Like me apply to a brand new team, but not for after going to 5 or 6. If you continue to
maybe that's an extreme. Maybe half is a nice sweet spot. I remember, I don't want to quote the name of that coach, but he's one of my several mentors. He was always saying that always commit to 40% of your real capacity, not more than that, because he wanted to have the same kind of buffer. And this guy is a renowned technical lead at one company for last 25 years. No, you're actually taking less, but just to be able to do work. That's his point. All right, so. Yes. So very, very important point. So I have one last slide before we take some kind of break, because we blabbered on this for a long time. So this one is about estimation. This is one more quote from Corey Ladas's essay. And he talks about this Nirvana state of Scrumban, which is more like level 2 Scrumban. So he talks about planning happening at a cadence with synchronized review retrospective. But his point is, again, just look at how many slots we can fill in based on our capacity, the slots in the request queue or input queue or next queue, whatever you want to call it. So his point is that time spent during batch processing for iteration planning estimation can be replaced with a QC infection at the time the work is promoted to ready queue. So what he means is, rather than planning work and estimating it during the planning meeting, he says, I would rather do QC checks like definition of ready, rigor in terms of whatever standards you have to say something is ready. That's what he wants. To promote work from planning board to the execution board in its ready queue, I would rather spend time on QC on that transition from planning Kanban, portfolio Kanban board to the execution Kanban board. He says do quality work in terms of a quality requirement so that it will be. No, in this context it is ready, definition of ready, because you are talking about promoting to ready. Do you know even that the requirement is way beyond discovery phase? That's what it is. Right? So take quality requirements so that you will produce quality. That's the point.
It's only more common day than
He's a Kanban expert. He's world-renowned Kanban. So he wrote this Kanban book. He is the creator of Kanban, Corey Ladas. Corey Ladas and David Anderson worked at a company called Corbis, which is the basis of the Kanban book.
Yeah, so my point is, they are more Kanban guys.
No, actually, between the two, Corey Ladas is more more of a Scrum believer. And I like his writing. He's a very practical guy. Absolutely. Now that's the release planning context. But even you, sure. Yes, absolutely. So even at the his point is even during iteration planning, rather than focusing on estimating the work, focus on destination of ready of the work so that it will become much more estimable and iterate. There is E for estimability, right, in invest. So that's where. Sometimes it can be. Sometimes estimation can be a process by itself, right?
Yeah, I think it's very closely tied with how clear your decision is done.
No, this is ready. This is definition of ready. Yeah.
Readiness because of standby.
Yes.
That is why we are saying, so I think, I really don't feel it is one or the other. Correct me here. If your excessive experience has definition of ready in Kanban, really clear, why is it difficult to know the why not?
No. All he's saying is, instead of spending time on estimating work, I would rather spend time on making it radiable, meaning making, this is talking about work that can be promoted from planning board, planning Kanban board or portfolio Kanban board to execution Kanban board. And you put it on the input queue. What you put on the input queue better be really, really worth executing. That's all he's saying.
I have a question. Estimation. When you're using 5, 7, 10, 20, 20,
Yes.
And how it is related with your doing it in Kanban? In Kanban we are not doing estimation, but what we are doing, we are trying to break the story into equal sizes.
Mm-hmm.
So we are doing some kind of estimation here also.
Agree. Your estimation is based on level of effort rather than any other attribution.
Like we are putting effort. We are doing the planning poker and we are putting effort in.
So let me give his example. The work that I am estimating to break down to 1 week time box for Kanban or Kanban can be low complexity, medium complexity, extreme complexity. I don't really care. All I'm saying is what can I do in the next week so that I can move cards on the Kanban board. The value of estimation is to make that requirement promotable. That's all you're really doing here. You see what I mean, right? Yes. Then, correct.
So it is.
Kanban doesn't necessarily say that you have to use hours or story points. There is no stands in Kanban. Yes. You can do relative sizing and continue doing that even in Kanban. Nobody stops us doing that. It's just that we don't use that relative size anywhere in terms of metric and replenishment. That's about it.
When you say we don't, just here we
don't. Or nowhere. Replenishment of Kanban board is purely based on the stats around lead times and cycle times. It has nothing to do with really the size of the work that you are doing.
So that's what I'm trying to get. So if you're Scrum on, you lean still towards the Scrum estimation or you use the lead time. That's what I was trying to get.
Yeah, so.
Or do you use the lead time?
Yeah.
Which one do you pick or fit it either?
Yes, so going back to this slide.
Yeah.
The focus is always on lead time and cycle time when it comes to Scrum.
Which one?
Yes.
So don't use story. You don't have to use story.
No. You can. It's not about estimation. Yes, and either way, your replenishment of work is not based on the size in any manner. It is based on the lead cycle time calculation.
It seems confusing as you're moving to Kanban, Scrum on. You know what I mean? It's a little confusing because Scrum on doesn't look at things, right?
It does. So that's exactly what made me put these quotes from the article. The moment you use the term Scrum on, we're talking now in terms of lead time, not burn down. Like here, just on this slide. Burn down you can use, but you have to actually look at.
But you still can use story points with Scrum.
That's fine. It doesn't really matter. Yeah.
And you can use lead time.
Mm-hmm. For planning. Lead time is for planning. Yeah.
But you don't use the story points for planning based on burn down velocity.
Yeah. It doesn't really help you. Correct. Yeah. All right. So we have seen this slide. In the sense that this is straight from the questions and the explanations from the evaluation question. So this is an example of evaluation. You can add more questions than you want. So we already used this evaluator, nothing new there. So with maybe 5 to 10 minutes break, I want to cover this. This is critical. Yes. How do I pause here? Mute? I'm still in that meeting.
You cannot stop the pause. I don't know. I'm not
sure. Yes, I will mute it, I think. Oh. I think it's pause. Okay, good. I'm on the phone. All right. So 3 feedback loops, daily stand-up, the system capability review. This is the term that Mike Burrows and David Anderson have started using rather than what we were told 4 months back. During our Kanban coaching masterclass, we were told to call it input queue replenishment daily. Maybe that was such a heavy name that they called it capability review. I mean, it's the same idea. do you have capability to take on more work? That's really what you do in that meeting, based on your stats, lead time stats.
So that's planning number, planning meeting number three, right? Or the 3 days. Because STEM, you've got the...
So if we were to...
Initial planning, then you have the stand-up.
So look at the level. So ops review is organizational level. Capability review is more at the team or department level. And then and stand up is at the team level. So three levels of reviews. And then one thing I read recently is that even though there is no formal retrospective in Kanban or Scrumban for that matter, level two Scrumban, you have to go stick to the Kanban model here. You don't have to consider planning, demos, and retrospectives as discrete events. This is very important. Planning is not a discrete event in Kanban, nor is demo, nor retrospective. The moment you feel something is going wrong, you do something about it in terms of continuous improvement rather than discrete improvement at some in a batch. See what I mean?
So literally on a daily basis, you're trying to improve the process.
Absolutely. So for example, imagine adding swim lane, new swim lane, or adding a sub row or adding sub columns on a queue or swim lane. That can happen during a meeting actually. It need not be planned or those kind of, yes. So also WIP limit adjustments based on capacity, people's timeouts and all of that. You do it on the fly. You don't really have to wait for some status call. So this section here talks about the difference between Scrum and Kanban standards. So the focus is on flow. You read the board from right to left. Like in the simulation game, if you remember, we were doing sanity checks. Are we over the WIP limit and all that? So you do that. And then what else? The focus is also from top to down in terms of what you see on the top should be expedite or fixed, what as you go scroll down should be lower priority. Tooling unfortunately creates a block sometimes. So when you are using Rally and you have a lot of fixed card tickets, if each of those fixed card tickets has due date on it, you have to manually order it according to the increasing order updates. Rally doesn't do it automatically for you. And also, you want to be careful about showing a standard class card. Always, it has to be always below the fixed card. Keep that in mind. In Rally, it doesn't care which card, which class of service it's showing under what.
Fixed time standard, that's what you said, correct?
Yes. Yeah. So fixed cards are like, they have due date.
Yeah.
They should always be visible. Right, they should be in the fold. If I have to use the UI, UX concept of showing in the fold, right? What the page shows first is always what people remember. So the other thing is, if there are bottlenecks developing, you look at the bottlenecks and talk about it rather than focusing on who created the bottleneck and going into the history of it. The focus is on eliminating or reducing that bottleneck, or moving that bottleneck. Typically, bottleneck is an excess WIP situation or a blocked situation due to dependency and such.
There's a whole like a Scrum standard.
Yes. Even Scrum standards, some expert coaches I've seen coaching them, they say that if you are asking the three questions, start with the blocked question first. If you are 100% co-located, never talk about what I did yesterday, because it doesn't matter, everybody knows it.
So if you say, just stick to two question format, talking about impediments first. Today I have been impedimented on this, and then
I've done the check, but what I'm trying to say is you should have that, whether it's physical or virtual, you know, semi-circle folks, scrum, each person gets a talk.
Yes, yes.
So with Kanban, we start with, and literally you may go from the left to the right on the scrum board.
That's true.
With Kanban, there's two subtle differences.
One, yes.
The semi-circle still is, could be there, but it's more about looking at from the right to the left.
Yes, yes.
Having the whole team swarm on the block stories of the bottlenecks. As a team,
yes.
Anybody can potentially speak up versus having to go through every single individual. And I have 25 people on this call now.
Yes, absolutely.
And that's a very different dynamic, you know, trying to get all that done in 15 minutes.
Yeah, I agree with you.
Exactly.
That's it. That's the point there.
You're
yeah.
Right. Start with the, you don't care, we don't really care what
yes.
You did yesterday unless somebody was waiting for that. That's an important thing.
Sure,
waiting.
Sure, sure. Yes. Yes. Yes.
This is Pete. Yeah.
Yes. And especially especially when you run into virtual Kanban, you will come across a lot of strange situations. Typical situation is if your WIP limits are high in some queues, and if you are coming closer to the WIP limits, and maybe you are exceeding some of them, you have to go back to some of the best practices that Arne Rup talks about in B, stop starting, start finishing. There is a measles practice. Did I mention about that? So measles practice is start blocking cards and say that we don't have capacity to work. And don't count those blocked cards and stay within the limit that way. So it's like a board with measles. That's what Arne Rup talks about. So read that book, it has got some fun practices. And I don't mind using this for scrum board also. Why not? I really want to visualize work.
So as just, I don't know if we want you to exercise, but just maybe we do it offline. But how would you do, you know, what were the three stories, three cards, and analysis or
yes, yes.
And doing BI analysis, ETL analysis. I've got five cards, and this one is three, it turns red. Mm-hmm. How would I go about? You're saying put blocks, figure out what the top three stories, the top three cards of this five, it have to be done in this time box.
Right. So when and you
secondly, which ones do you
right.
Block? Yeah.
So in Kanban, or even in Scrum for that matter, when you are using physical board, you put a block on a card. Obviously, you are not working on that card. So there must be some other cards that I would be working on, and that's how it's just a visualization technique, right? All right, then what? So this part of it is shaping the demand. Shaping the demand, replenishing the demand based on average lead time is something that we'll talk about when we go to the metrics section. So this meeting is to shape demand, that you are moving some portfolio work to execution now. And how do you shape that demand that is coming from planning to execution? No. All it says is what is your average lead time, and based on that, on an average, when can you really start working on something new?
Okay.
If my average lead time is 2 days, then every second day I should add a card. It's as simple as that. Now, whether I actually have a meeting to just discuss one card every 2 days doesn't make sense, right? Maybe I will have a meeting to discuss 5 or 6 cards for half an hour every Friday, because maybe we will be close to that. So you have to adjust your cadence based on what you really are doing. That is what he was talking about. Ops review is really not different than the ops reviews that happen. So that meeting is, I don't fully yet understand what is that Kanban method is adding from value perspective over what people were already doing.
Uh-huh.
Yes, same kind of, because all you're saying is,
when you are reviewing your operations, what are the process improvement opportunities at that level that you review? See, it's a feedback, right? We are reviewing, we find some, yeah, we are finding some dysfunction because of handoffs or something. So you will actually discuss that in that meeting. Yeah, they call it ops review, but that's where I was coming.
Non-execution team members, probably managers, the least managers.
Yeah, all FTEs listen in.
Really on process improvement, it's just a feedback mechanism.
Yes.
So maybe that's an opportunity for improvement for the organization.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe that's an opportunity to talk about it.
And I, you know, currently, like Steve said, maybe they are focused on, no, so maybe right now, maybe for since February, the focus has been on reviewing the portfolios and what have you. Another 6 months when people are used to using Value Portfolio Manager, and if that coloring really improves in terms of projections, projected colors, maybe the focus will go away from projections to something else. You see what I mean? And those are your improvement opportunities.
Yeah, we're just looking at the today with promotion.
Yeah, yeah.
Trying to figure out what you guys are looking at and what's important and how do we foster those leading natural values for management, right?
Yeah. So for so I want to quickly go through the metrics section, but for some reason I have lost colors.
I have no idea why.
Is there any way to get colors back?
Actually, you have colors. You have blue, maroon, or reddish.
Yeah, there are three colors. Yeah, I know. Yeah, I think. So we are going to learn two things here. One is how do you coach teams on adjusting WIP? In specific, total WIP. Total WIP is WIP for all the columns added together until you hit the first case meeting. That is called total business Kanban. So we want to see how we learn to coach teams on adjusting that total based on their empirical evidence, which is their trend, throughput trend, lead time trend, and so on. The other thing which is baseline for that is this formula, which we will talk about. So that is that, and then we will see these three metrics, the lead time, variability, and also the expected distribution curve. We will get that part. Due date performance. This is if you have due dates on card. If you don't have them, then no matter whether you were on time or not, chart will not show you. So metrics, you want to be sure that if you don't have raw data for it, it will not really show that, even if teams was doing better than what it showed for those data. Alright, so I'm also planning to cover a little bit on forecasting technique called Monte Carlo forecasting that I have to picture for. Alright. So this part of the section is really useful if you focus on this for a minute. I have given all the links to those topics that I thought are useful here from Scrum team's perspective. So first of all, frequency distribution. In knowledge work, unlike lean manufacturing, frequency distributions are not bell-shaped. They are hump curves. They have a shape of a hump. Right? They have a long tail. They don't have a symmetric distribution like a bell curve has. Right? So the reason is that the modal value tends to be a lot much smaller than what you see in lean manufacturing, according to this point.
So when you are looking at lead time distribution, remember we created a frequency curve during the simulation game. So the way you want to read this information is, this thing likes to do work of this kind. That's what they remember. So when you're looking at this illustration here, that's what they remember. See here, teams will always remember that they mostly finish their work in 2 weeks. Scrum team. Median is when you have a large sampling, half of the sampling is before and half of that after. It's just like median home price. Average is just the average of all the time. And then 75th percentile is useful. If you see all these colors, they are different numbered percentiles. And then you have 98th percentile considered as your control limit. Also sprint duration if it is frequency distribution for a scrum sprint. So anytime you work with a Kanban team, you want to at least have these three numbers, if not the other percentile. So when you, for example, look at this data, it may be like 2 days. See that? This is their most frequent lead time. So they typically do work in 2 days. That's how you would read this chart. If not, they take 15 days, maybe that's 15. And then the third best is 12 days, something like that. So you can, when you have these kind of data points, you say you now have three top frequencies. You have the model value of 2 days. You have the second best of 17 or whatever that is, and this 12. So 2, 17, 12. You have 3 points. Let the team discuss some events that caused that 17. You start thinking about outliers here as well. That why do you think we have these one story each that took those many days? Like they have frequency of one, it's still zero, but it's really Excel. Excel, there is some bug in charting. But the point about this is that you create some discussion opportunities. Let them discuss some outliers here. Typically in frequency curve, this is called tail, long tail. And you want to not ignore the long tail. There must be reason why that tail was that much long. So while you are discussing the model values and the next best value, you are also discussing these outliers.
So as far as capturing the data,
yes.
Yes.
Shows the data. Yes. Yeah. Absolutely.
What about the accuracy?
Pretty good. Pretty good.
What was killing it off before? The projects that you looked at. How do we avoid that? Just making sure you have your visualization board correctly set up with the right category, right states,
mm-hmm.
and that you don't put cards in ready
and
just let
them
sit there.
Yes, so some of the things that you want to do for your Kanban and Kanban team is to switch to just-in-time execution method. So you can have planning, create parent stories for features in Ravi Portfolio Manager, and what can be done in the week after you create the story, parent story in Rally that you have tied back to some feature, think about what can be done in weekly increment, and then add the stories according to which week you are in, rather than creating them upfront. So that way they will have shortest possible lead time. That way you create the sustainability.
Just so that's the kind of rule we had is we laid out some of the stories across multiple time boxes.
Mm-hmm.
They all show the continuity, they all show the continuity, the ones that are sitting we're in time box 2 right now, and we've got cards sitting in time box 3 and 4.
Yes.
In the request column. They're not ready yet.
Mm-hmm.
Even if their requests are going to be counted, right? The lead time is counting. Right?
Yeah, yeah, very much. Yes. Yes. So those.
I think in terms of the metrics that you're concerned about, you should have record to see when the ready checkbox.
No, that is not lead time. That is according to Rally, ready to accepted is the cycle time. Completed, I think, not accepted. Yeah. We are not looking at cycle time at all. We are looking at... Yeah. So that's why, that is the reason why what we do for, from Rally's point of view, we create parent story, which will never show on any Kanban board. Portfolio Kanban board shows only initiatives and features. Execution Kanban board will only show leaf node story, not the parent story, ever, right? So you create a parent story for a work that will take more than a week, and then only have cards that correspond to the child cards for that parent story on a week-by-week basis, just in time. The point is that you want to have... Yes, absolutely. The cards should be created just in time. The point about this is, we call it left shifting the hump curve. So you see this hump curve, right?
Mm-hmm.
What you're trying to do is you're trying to move your median and average to the left. In these articles, you see that term used, left shifting the frequency curve.
So
the point about that
is... Can you tell me about the y-axis and
x-axis
over here?
This is not the
frequency.
This is the same. Illustrated in much better way with different colors.
So frequency is
how many stories?
How many?
So here, what is it?
9 stories.
Yeah, so 9 stories have 2. So this is the model value. That's what they remember. Typical.
And this
offer,
is the lead,
right?
Lead text.
This is lead text, yes. Got it, right? So you always focus on lead time distribution in Kanban.
This is very nice.
Rally does not show lead time distribution curve.
Yeah, I think this is a very nice for you, right?
Yes.
Here shows the lead time is very less for most of the majority.
Yeah, this is example you mean.
Exactly.
I mean, it is 40 days.
Having cards in the future time boxes.
Yes.
Even though they're in the request call. They're still being kept.
Yeah, because it's creation to
be.
Yeah. So
that means we got to do a...
No. All your...
We got to be doing a system capability review every time box in order to do this right.
You have to direct your average lead time. You cannot. So this example here, right? 33 working days average, mean is 26, and mode is 0. 0 because of whatever reason, right? So... If you say that they love to do work in 26 days, typically, but their average is 33, you are hovering somewhere between what you like to do and what you are really doing on an average. You are somewhere in the middle. That is why the median is always between average and model value. You see that? Any Kanban team or Scrum team here, the moment you create this chart in Excel or Tableau, you will see that the median is always less than more. I mean, average. Almost always. So these three data points are important. They give you a lot of cues about how the team is performing and when to replenish work, how they can shape the demand. Is all based on this. That example there is, let's say, if that team handles DM of tickets, 4 tickets on an average per day, that's their delivery rate. But if their lead time is 13 days on an average, 13 days for each ticket on an average, by the time somebody from 45 Agile team is creating the DM of ticket for the operations to resolve that ticket, 13 days on an average, your team, right? 4 tickets per day, delivery time, delivery rate, which is similar to throughput. So multiplication of that, 13 fours are 52 or something. We found that their WIP limit, total WIP limit, addition of all columns up to accepted, column is 56, meaning they should not have any time more than 56 cards there on the Kanban board, period. Simple as that. So you have to look at it that way. That's why these stats are so important.
Let's say a team wants to use, like each wants to use Kanban.
Yes.
They need to do some kind of a release plan.
Yes.
Because they have to make a commitment.
Yes.
So all of that and all those user stories need to be kept out of Rally.
No.
Yes.
I don't want to do that. No. Hear me out. You do release plan. You have, let's say, thought about next 3 months. You have those 3 months worth of stories. It is not about whether you put the stories in a physical wall or virtual Kanban board or not. That's not the point here. The point is, what is the capability of the team? What is the capacity, true capacity of the team in terms of skill set and ability to finish that work? If you have a large batch size in Kanban, not in manufacturing, if you have a large batch size like that, the obvious thing is that your average lead time is going to move to the right. Get me right? If your goal is to have fastest possible lead time and cycle time, what can I do to enable that? That should be what I should do.
Yeah, but
it's not the mechanics of whether I'm front
no,
the
no,
system.
But if you want, if you want the data, yes, to be accurate, and you put the stories in months in advance, just because.
I asked a similar question in a different way, not the release planning context, but what Anderson told me, Maitra, what Anderson told me was that the reason why you are looking at average and median is just because work is not of similar size. If work was of similar size, then your average would have been very, the curve would be like this. You see what I mean?
Answer my question,
exactly.
And be a politician.
No.
You're answering a different question.
Yes.
So what should a team do here if they want to do some kind of a release plan? Should they create the, we'll call them requirements?
So the way I handle this problem is this way. No. I alluded to this in the morning to her. All the front-loaded release plans, all the front-loaded release plan has stories for that three-month period. The actual work that they do are cards related to the stories in the plan. So if I'm in sprint one, you said you have sprint one with these 12 stories. I may not necessarily need those 12 stories. I may consider some of those as parent stories. You're getting me, right?
Yes, but you're saying
No, hold on. Let me complete. Yes, that is how I run even in pure Kanban. Reason is, hear me out please. Reason is, not really. Reason is you are trying to create a distribution that is symmetric, predictable, statistically speaking. If I have 12 stories to work on in terms of DM ops tickets, if I can only produce 4, there's no way I can look at the remaining 8. So the way I can tackle that is, I can create child stories.
Quite honestly, that is not even a correct correlation. It is not even a correct analogy, because the tickets are really ad hoc. This is not. You are release planning.
Sure.
You are release planning for a quarter. So
doesn't matter. Hear me out.
No, because the work already exists in your spinning system, like what happens with off.
Sure.
Tickets are created any time.
Okay.
Right now, we
fine.
Don't have
fine,
a
fine,
actor, fine. And another thing, you're actually talking about tickets come with SLA.
Mm-hmm.
There's an SLA thing which is critical.
Yes.
Have it done in the next
one. New NPD can also involve SLA. Why not? If
fine,
if your VP says, I want this product with this feature in next 3 months, that's the SLA for it, right? You have a due date already established.
No. Then you're already working on it. This is, look at the example that we're saying.
Mm-hmm.
And even your solution, quite honestly, Ravi, is create a parent, then create a child just in time.
That really is how Kanban works.
All I'm saying is, probably Kanban is not effective. If you're doing such a plan Mm-hmm. You're saying, I'm really tired. I'm giving you the entire over the subset of work that needs to be done.
Mm-hmm.
Plan one quarter ahead of time.
Yes.
Your solution is to manage a lead time, create sales stories, not the exact child story.
Mm-hmm.
We are in a position here to estimate the child story, put a number on it, and also plan when you want to take it. Something of Kanban.
That's fine.
No,
hear me out. Well, please
right?
hear. Naitra, you're making calls because what you're saying, and this is a very dogmatic statement, that people who do release planning should not use Kanban. This
I'm
is what you're saying.
No, I'm not.
That is not the reality. Kanban is being used in companies with upfront planning. The point about this is portfolio. Portfolio plan. Portfolio Kanban is for planning. Execution Kanban is for execution. What you talk about, when you say release plan, I can only imagine portfolio Kanban or what Anderson calls upstream Kanban.
Why can't it be down to an execution level?
Portfolio Kanban is portfolio. It is not
execution.
So in execution, you are taking a car. If you take a car and don't have child stories that have a equal size. Let's take this example, right here. There are these cards which are 50 days. Let's say these were 13 point stories for the heck of argument. Let's say, right? 13 and 25, right? Let's say this middle ground between 20 to 40 had somewhere between 5 and 8. Let's say. And let us say that anything less than 20 days was 1, 2, 3, something of that sort, right? If I in anything, whether Scrum team or Kanban, if I have smaller, similar size stories, Scrum works even better. Agree or not?
Okay, Ravi, your
so question is about decomposition.
My point is just this. Those number of stories that are at 5, that is 8 times, should be ideally at 6 feet because it took that much time. Not
sure,
just sitting in your backlog.
So that's fine. But that is
that's all I'm saying.
And
that
is fair.
No. What? Please understand what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, go ahead.
What I'm saying is lead time is not the metric then for them. Either it should be cycle time. See, when you start working on the story, you are going to look at lead time as a metric, then the kind of release planning technique that
but
Greg was talking about.
Can I tell you, when you use cycle time as a metric, the reason there are some references here why cycle time is not used in Kanban anymore.
Right.
I can go into those references and talk about it. I have referenced your the point about lead time, why lead time is important than cycle time is because customers feel the lead time. Cycle time can be as fast as you can, but if you are delivering the customer the goods and the customer is gone, it doesn't do any good.
Because your assumption right there was you make the story only when the customer asked you to make it. That's your assumption.
So the point is
you answer right.
Yes. So the reason why you want to have smallest possible amount of work in Kanban or Scrum is because you want to finish it in given available time, right? If you're saying 1 week card, that just creates that sustainable phase.
So Ravi, let's talk about the situation we have at hand. They are doing They have a release plan. Let's talk about this example, right?
Yes.
I'm not, quite honestly, I want to get into the practical aspect. After a release plan, each is a very planned program.
Yes,
they know what deliverable they have.
Yes.
The customer has come and told them, I want this deliverable, and it means that I need a quarter, an entire quarter.
Yes,
let's plan it out.
Yes.
They break it.
Yes.
The teacher to use
but do you know why peak has, okay. So do you know why peak is Kanban team? The reason is those people who are working in peak are also supporting several things which come as unplanned work.
Sure, my question is
right around. If there are dedicated teams of cross-functional engineers that are not doing anything but peak, then they better be scrum team for that period of 3 or 4 months.
No, you're saying the same language and speaking. Exactly
they are dedicated scrum team.
That is what
then
I'm asking. My assumption is they are working on this delivery.
Yeah.
And they have fully planned it out.
Yes. And they will not work on anything else.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Then in that case, telling me do not create the story now Because of lead time, that concept to me, that concept I don't mind. I mean, just because you're talking about getting the metric. See, okay, I don't want to gain the metric, right? I have a story. What can I write?
So if that's the case, you will have higher average lead time, but less predictive lead. Your throughput will also be longer.
I'm just saying that that's not a metric.
It doesn't matter. Okay, so in Scrum, it doesn't matter whether you look at lead time or not. Right? You're just looking at how much you can really do in terms of your velocity and plan accordingly.
So, lead time in Scrum world,
yeah, that's true. But, teams that can really, even in Scrum teams, I always bench for equal size. Even as a Scrum team, if I can have things of equal size, I can iterate much better. Between the two options.
How can you make it?
That looks good on paper. In practical, you cannot have stories of equal. Everything is different.
You cannot bend them further down.
You can break down further down, but it will not be same as the other user story that you are putting. We can categorize a set of user stories as one category and the other.
I can please. I want to stick to Kanban today and I have found effective ways to deal with Scrum teams where variability of work causes unpredictability. There are ways of decomposition to tackle that problem. And if you create work of similar size even in Scrum teams,
our intention is not to talk about Scrum either. All we're seeing is, at least from my perspective, I don't think I should create a story just in time. So the lead time, which is the metric that we are looking at, work. That for me is almost like gaming. That for me is that.
Not really. How else are you going to produce work? If I have a Kanban board where there are wait times.
You
gave me the card. So let me clarify.
You cannot allow him. You didn't allow me.
Could you pick up more Rally for a second? Show an example of what you're talking about.
This is being recorded. I will tell about what I have experienced here with my Kanban team. I want to stick to the deck here in the interest of time available. I want to just take this question and move on. The point about splitting work in this manner is to create sustainable pace. The point about Kanban is there is a planning portfolio Kanban. That's just for planning. That is planning for work. We do not know when that work gets completed.
Okay.
That is not execution Kanban. We call it upstream Kanban.
So like a robot?
I have given a reference, Kanban.
Oh my god.
Yeah, so Kanban, what was the book that I gave you yesterday? So that Anderson and Mike published. So anyway, the point about having two separate Kanban boards is that one is used for planning, the other for execution. When you pass on work for planning board to the execution board, you want to create sustainable space of execution. You create sustainable space of execution by having a left shifting answer or left shifting frequency curve. You can only achieve that when work is of bite size. Okay, right? Your execution relates to planning perspective in portfolio Kanban board. Somehow you have layers of parent stories and features and what have you. So the point is that your portfolio is getting completed and you have higher visibility of what is getting done. If you do not do that, then last year's Bernie Clark and Heinz Kanban board would have been plentiful. You would not have any story moving. I still can show you some Kanban teams with wait times of 100 days, 200 days.
they don't even look at it.
That's fine.
So the point, so the point is that by creating smaller work, you are creating sustainable things. That's the point about it.
One question, can you promote story from planning to
Well, in rally, I can talk about physical board.
Physical board is up to you, right? You are manual control.
Yes.
In rally,
yeah.
You have to do release planning and you dump all the stories
yes.
in your planning board and move it to the execution
board
just in time.
So can I tell you, rally does not have planning Kanban board. Rally software does not have planning Kanban board. All other Kanban tools have planning boards treated separately. Namekit is an example. Swift Kanban is another example. They have planning Kanban boards separately treated, completely separate boards, physical, I mean virtual boards, than you can drag and drop cards from there.
Yeah, that's
what I'm saying. That you can do there, not here.
That would help.
Yeah. And in that context, really speaking, you're talking about locally the cycle time when it comes to execution. So, because if the card existed over there,
Exactly.
So it becomes local.
Local lead time.
Yeah. So local cycle time, not lead time.
Right.
Lead time is when you actually have the requirement.
No, but you count now lead time from the moment it came to your execution book.
That's not how that concept is. It's customer aspect, right? It's not product manager. The moment you create that requirement, it then clock time.
So the only way, in our mind, the way we set up our peak, is to speed up the situation. I'm on planning board. We added in 2-week time boxes, which are really set up with iteration, scrum iteration feature. And now we have so you have a drop-down list of you're on the Kanban board, released 1.0 peak. All the stories are viewable through one Kanban board. Another one is the iteration view.
Yes.
And we have 2-week time boxes, so each, it's a drop-down list of time box 1 and N. I'm on time box 1, I just see the stories for time box 1. But because I did my release planning by laying out the stories across multiple time boxes, I'm being penalized right now, which means being penalized because lead time is
Right.
The only my quick and dirty way to fix that is to all of a sudden schedule these replenishment meetings every 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
So pull all the stories out of the future time boxes, tag them somehow as time box 1 to N, dump them back into the release backlog.
So then it's
just rank stack and then pull them out of there for each time box. That's my only
You're talking about
without
solving this problem now, okay? What you just described is how you see swim lanes in rally. That's what you're describing.
It's a workaround. Short of having to create parent and child relationships, which is too complicated for my team to understand what stories show up on what board and which ones are hidden, it's too much over there.
Okay.
So I'm just throwing that out there.
Greg and Nitra, this is the way you are supposed to use Kanban in a just-in-time system. If you are working in a planned environment, you use something which is a mix of Scrum and Kanban. There are things in Kanban that are more useful in Scrum than other ways. Small batch size is a Kanban concept. It's not a Scrum concept.
I'm just smiling because I said this like 20 minutes ago and I got big time to invite to say so much Scrum. But it's on record. You can go back
and listen. So Nitra, you are the greatest person here. I have no question about that. Can we continue, please?
And I also have a record that you nodded your head non-verbally that was an acceptable workaround I just described.
Both of you are absolutely right, sir.
In 30 seconds, it's described.
Sure. So, my point of all this, so in summary, when you look at frequency distribution, can I continue please? In summary, when you look at frequency distribution curves,
your goal should be always to see if you can left shift the frequency distribution curve. And yeah, that was the point there. The other thing important for Kanban is SLA adherence. This is critical for teams that are working in a completely unplanned model. It doesn't mean that these teams are just operations teams. Even R&D teams that don't have fixed plans and roadmaps can use something like this to create sustainability within their working environment. So this kind of chart helps you see what is the team really doing in terms of due dates, and what this gives you some data points. The most important one though is flow efficiency. And by the way, these three metrics that you just saw, lead time distributions, due date performance reporting, as well as flow efficiency, you can apply to any kind of teams. It need not be a Scrum team or Kanban team or Kanban team or waterfall. I can always look at lead times of waterfall teams or Scrum teams. For example, in Scrum, if the lead times on an average are 2 weeks, you can predict that they have hockey stick burn down. So you can make some judgmental calls and then decide your coaching strategy. Flow efficiency is actually an a very useful metric. It tells you what percentage of your lead time is actual work done in. So it tells you what is the time that you are actually taking as a percentage of lead time. So if the flow efficiency is higher, that means your planning and execution is very, very synchronized, that you are not planning too much upfront and executing when you really can. The point in Kanban is plan when you really have to execute. That's really what the process model is.
So is that different than touch time?
That is touch time. So touch time divided by, yeah, so touch time divided by lead time is what you're looking at here. Now in knowledge industry, yeah, I know. I don't think we need to, no, that's fine. No, that's okay. I don't think so. Touch time over lead time. Now please, no questions, so that I can finish within the battery available. So according to Anderson, so 15% flow efficiency is pretty good, and so you want to watch out for that. All right. Last slide that I want to cover is this one, Monte Carlo simulation. This has been in use for a long time. This has been used for predicting potential delivery dates based on empirical data. So make sure that you have enough empirical data so that your predictions are much more reliable. You cannot, for example, have just 20% of empirical evidence to predict the remaining 80%. That is just insane. You want to. Most of the experts like Dimitar who talks about this, it's like you got to have 45 days data to predict to have a 30 days forecast. So in other words, you have to have 60% of empirical evidence to predict the remainder 40%. It cannot be any less because the degree of uncertainty is higher. This is a technique used. Control chart is another thing that we use in conjunction with the lead time distribution frequency curve. This quickly tells you what are your outliers and much more visibly because it is date based, not frequency based. The last topic is about the team assessment that I want to quickly cover. There are six dimensions here in this example of team agility assessment. This is the original one that Anderson came up with. Visualization, how good are you as a Kanban team? Limiting WIP, how good are you as a Kanban team? Managing flow, explicit policies, this is like definition of ready, done, Q
queue level explicit policies, swim lane level explicit policies, and so on. Feedback loops. Are you really doing it, or like in Scrum, sometimes newbie teams skip retrospective. Where are you? So that and the remainder is that. Will it save the recording? In WebEx it does. I don't know about this software. Okay. Yeah, I had just two more slides on the